The following video is for entertainment purposes only. The scenarios presented within have been heavily edited and are neither complete nor meant to act as or in lieu of actual flight instruction. Consult a certified flight instructor for more information. Wind, equipment issues, and rain. But hey, we're a traveling band. I'm John Weisswasser, pilot and drummer for Eaglemania. Follow me as I explore the practical use of general aviation while I travel the country with the world's greatest tribute to the Eagles. This is Life in the Fast Lane. Goal of this mission is to go from Caldwell, New Jersey to Cleveland, Ohio, and do one show with Eaglemania, and then go from Cleveland to Irwin, Pennsylvania for two shows, and then fly back Sunday morning for Mother's Day. The first leg, Caldwell to Cleveland, will involve landing at Burke Lakefront around noon, meet up with John Gechter at the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame for a little while, and then sound checking and performing at the Music Box Supper Club. The next day, I'll fly from Burke to Latrobe for two shows in Irwin, Pennsylvania at the Lamp Theater, arriving anytime so long as I make sound check on time. And finally, Sunday is Mother's Day, and I need to get back in time to make a day out of it. Checking Windy TV for the outlook for the 4 days that I plan to travel. Thursday looks like the issue is going to be wind and some slight possibility of convection. Friday brings some marginal VFR conditions at Latrobe, but Sunday has Caldwell under IFR with low ceilings, reduced visibility, and winds favoring the runway served by the non-precision approach. So briefing it the morning before, the major issue seemed to be just some wind at Burke when I plan to land with the frontal system off to the west. The winds were forecast to be gusting to 22. By the morning of, however, that had changed to 18 gusting to 28 with thunderstorms after 4 p.m. Caldwell was still supposed to stay VFR, but now there was some possibility of heavy icing at the mid-altitudes along my route, which meant to me that I should be prepared for the frontal system to be moving faster than forecast in the TAF. This was confirmed in the graphical area forecast.
So leaving for the airport a little earlier than planned, some precip, some convection moving into the area a little earlier than what was forecast, and I want to get a head start on that. Plus, the crosswinds at Burke are supposed to be pretty significant, maybe gusting to 28 straight across the runway. So should be an interesting flight. I want to get a head start on it.
I got my clearance, which initially had my final altitude at 16,000 feet, something which I was able to renegotiate to 28,000 feet as soon as I got handed off to New York Center. Startup and takeoff were routine, as was the 25-minute hold for release.
Cutlass 43 Delta, winds are 070 at 10, gust 17, runway 4 clear, touch and go.
Clear, touch and go, runway 443 Alpha.
Hey, 60 knots, cross check. T5, rotate. Coming up. A damper on. We're here at flight level 280. And pretty smooth ride.
Solo 6198, descend maintain flight level 180.
We'll descend maintain flight level 180, solo 6198.
Taking a look ahead at area of weather. Moving into Cleveland. There might be just some shower activity for now. I think we'll make it before this batch gets there. Honestly, that doesn't look terribly convective. Meanwhile, the weather on the ground there, going winds 160 at 16, gusting to 24. And this is runway at 24 that we're planning on landing on. So it's going to be a little bit of a fight. But it's nice and long, and nice and long runway, so I don't think it should be too much of a problem.
Level 6239, New York City, right?
It was a pretty uneventful flight otherwise, as was the descent. I asked for and was given the RNAV to 24 via the initial approach fix, SICKID. During the descent and most of the approach, I had to slow down because of the moderate turbulence.
Number
Niner Delta Alpha, contact Lakefront Tower 124.3.
Over to Tower 9 Delta Alpha, so long.
That was 1547, contact Tower 1.
Number Tower Meridian 929 Delta Alpha with the outside tabby.
November 902, Niner Delta Alpha, Lakefront Tower, roger, continue inbound for runway 24 right, wind 190 at 17, gust 28.
Okay, we'll continue 9 Delta Alpha.
And November 9er Delta Alpha, runway 24 right, clear to land.
Clear to land, 24 right, 9 Delta Alpha.
There's no doubt in my mind that having had a lot of experience flying tail draggers makes a huge difference when it comes to landing, especially in a crosswind. For me, it's about a religious adherence to maintaining that center line. When flying a crosswind in a heavy airplane like that with a wing low, keeping that center line keeps you flying the airplane as opposed to the other way around.
November 9er Delta Alpha, continue, turn left taxiway Bravo, cross runway 24 left, say parking intention.
Okay, left on Bravo, cross 24 left, and we're signature 9 Delta Alpha.
Roger, taxi signature via Gulf Dish frequency.
That was a fight, thank you. We'll be with you, 9 Delta Alpha.
Roger, experience any gains or losses on final?
Not that I'm aware for 9 Delta Alpha.
Roger.
To be honest, I wasn't even paying attention. I was so focused on maintaining the center line. But there was something that did catch my eye on the rollout.
Was there a little mishap at the other end of the runway there?
Yeah, Super Cub exited runway, tapped his brakes, and wind caught his plane, and he went nose down.
Maybe that's why I didn't pay attention much to the airspeed, because this caught my eye over to the left. You can see it when I freeze the frame. But basically, just another reminder of why you got to fly the airplane until the engine's off and the chocks are on, especially in a tail dragger. So from there, it was off to the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, which is actually walking distance from Burke Lakefront, and a major reason to go there. If you've never been, it's actually really worth the trip. I mean, it really covers the entire span of rock and roll history, and it does it quite well. And I can't think of a better time to go than being on the road with Eaglemania, and especially going with my old buddy, John Gechter.
What do you think, John? Do you want one? Tell us all the things you know about how Paul McCartney was switched.
I can't say.
You can't say?
I'm not allowed to say.
Yeah. You've been sworn to secrecy.
John and I have been musical buddies now for a good decade. I rarely see him without a guitar in his hands, and he knows that instrument and the music behind it inside and out, and can quite literally play anything. John is a major, major focal point of our show and is the only member who routinely gets his own standing ovation, especially after Hotel California, where he is one guy who can play and cop the style of three very different guitarists all in succession. In addition, he's the one that brought me into Eaglemania in the first place.
Do you remember when you invited me?
Yeah, I remember calling you up, and I said, nah, this... I almost didn't call you because I thought, nah, Doctor, and I know you were playing with the Guest House Gorillas, and I said, nah, he was not going to be able to do it, you know? So, and we had already decided. Maybe right. This is why you owe me, because Frank was already decided on
the other guy. Right.
Yeah, he said, we're going with T. And I said, well, wait a minute. Hold on.
Yeah.
Let's try my buddy out.
John is truly a master of his craft. John's also got some crazy ideas, and it can be a lot of fun.
I believe it's certainly possible, yes.
Right. He was abducted by aliens and then switched, or the other way around?
No, I think Original Soul is still alive,
actually. It's Woodstock is the big bang of rock and roll. These guys, the V3, Carlos with the SG with the P90 straight into his amp, there's his curly cord. And no drum risers, like a little three-piece kit for Michael Shreve. Just amazing.
Just going with John to the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame was worth the flight out. The other thing is that he and I share very similar musical tastes.
What do you think?
Oh, this is 1999. I want the original.
I have a little bit of a problem. I get why all these people were inducted first. Elvis, Little Richard, Robert Johnson, yeah, Everly Brothers, James Brown, all that makes sense, okay? But when you go here to the next year, right, Lieber and Stoller were inducted before the Beatles. That doesn't make sense. And before the Stones. And I think the Stones should have gone in before the Beatles.
We got Life's Been Good.
Beautiful right.
Lyrics.
Life's Been Good.
Yeah. Touching the glass.
You could touch the glass.
Well, now we got Best of My Love.
And there was one other little perk I discovered before.
Not
the
often
show.
That you get this kind of view from your hotel room. And if I could just see over that beige hangar, I could see 9 Delta Alpha.
Bonus footage coming up for sure.
So from there, it was on to soundcheck and a pretty typical Eaglemania show.
Get to hit, John. Get to serious.
Almost a sold out house on a Thursday night.
Two,
not bad.
Two, one, two, you. Hey, Ken Dorsey. Something tells me this. You know, right by my door and,
The next leg involved flying the 134 miles between Cleveland and Latrobe, Pennsylvania for a pair at the Lamp Theater in Irwin. I had to arrive at least an hour before soundcheck. There was a cold front draped across my route with light to moderate rain and a slight chance of convection, and the forecast was for marginal VFR for most of the day, but totally doable. On the morning of, the radar demonstrated some lines of showers and some light to moderate icing potential in the middle teens, the bailout being to descend. Just before departure, the METARs were following the forecast with no adverse PIRAPs. There was a NOTAM for the ILS being out for an hour just around my arrival time, so I planned for the RNAV LPV to 2-4. So I filed for 17,000 feet and used the expected routing and went to the airport where the departure was routine.
Cleared to land, Lima 2 then. And we got King Air, traffic 4, which is also King Air 2, Lima Juliet, verify runway 24 right.
No sooner had I reached 17,000 feet when it was time to start descending.
Okay, they've started the descent, and I know the freezing level's around 12,000 feet. They descended us from 17,000 to 12,000, and just looking ahead, definitely going to be encountering some precip and maybe a little bit of ice. So we'll see. Our bailout is to ask for lower. I know that there's no forecast icing, say at 9,000 feet, which would be fine. So that's our bailout. So let's just see what's going on at 12,000, and we'll go from there.
Fast forwarding a little more.
Okay, we'll pick up the ATIS.
Single pilot IFR means listen to both frequencies.
Information November 1-5-4-7-1.
Request 34-53 for departure. Radar contact climbing team 1-4-14-1000.
All right,
1-4-14-1000. Temperature 1-9-0, 2.1-9-0. Meridian 9 Delta, descending team 5,000.
5,000, 9 Delta.
Approach arriving, departing runway 24. Hazardous in-flight weather advisories in effect and pilot weather reports.
So with no surprises, I went ahead and configured for the RNAV to 2-4.
Your knots are greater, out of 10,000. Turning 27 Cephas for departure, radar contact, climbing team 1-4-14,000.
All right, so we're just below the freezing level as we enter these clouds. So I am going to turn the prop heat and stall heat on, and I expect this to be a little bumpy here.
Once I broke out into warmer air, I turned all the anti-ice off, and the challenge then became picking through some of the larger cumulus buildups that others were contending with.
American 2077, like about 10 degrees left for buildup ahead.
American 2077, 10 degrees left approved when able, proceed direct 80.
10 left, 80 when able, American 2077.
All right, so that buildup straight ahead there, that we're going to have to go around.
It was hard to visually capture the size of the buildup with the GoPro, but the NEXRAD was definitely lagging it, and it needed to be circumnavigated. Fortunately, ATC beat me to the punch.
Meridian 9 Delta Alpha, fly heading 180 vector for descent.
Okay, 180 for 9 Delta Alpha.
And American 2077, turning back direct 80.
American 2077, roger, contact Cleveland Center on 126.95.
2695, American
2077. Meridian 9 Delta Alpha, menu out to descending team 6000.
6000, 9 Delta Alpha.
I continued the descent, was told to expect, and then went ahead and configured in brief for the RNAV to 2-4. They ultimately gave me direct to the initial approach fix, and from then on it was a routine approach.
Okay, glide path is capturing, gears going down. Three in the green, 10 of flaps, manual. And we're below flaps for 20 degrees, so we'll just go ahead and add that now. Okay, just a quick flow check.
Go off runway 24, tech
manual, three, manual. All right. We're not clear to land yet. We do have 20 degrees of flaps, 3 in the green.
It wasn't long after crossing the marker before I had the runway in sight.
I would call this a broken layer. And we're not quite at the base of it yet.
We in November 902, Niner Dot Alpha, runway 24, wind 240 at 16, you are clear to land.
Well, and 24, Niner Delta Alpha. 300 above minimums. I'm going to come off the autopilot.
500.
Add the last 10 degrees of flaps. Okay, one more check. We have everything's on, full flaps, 3 in the green. Autopilot and the yaw damper are both off.
Minimums.
So this isn't our first time to the Lamp Theater. In fact, I think it's our fourth or fifth time out there. Certain venues we just seem to resonate with strongly, and the Lamp is definitely one of them. We've never played there to less than a completely sold out crowd, and this time we sold out a pair.
So this is Bill Elder. Bill runs the LAMP.
So the LAMP Theater, it's a 1937 single screen movie theater. We do about 150 shows a year.
Right.
And this was a volunteer community project. So this was, everything you see in the theater was done by a volunteer.
Wow.
It's the big story. So there are only two employees here, myself and my administrative assistant.
Oh my God.
That's, and everybody else you see.
So it's like a real community effort.
Yes, it's an extreme community effort.
Right.
They run the place, they staff the place, and they come and patronize the place now.
Wow.
So we're very, very lucky to put it up though.
How big is Irwin? How big a town?
Irwin has less than 4,000 taxpayers in it. So it's a very, very small borough.
Right.
I mean, if you sneeze, you'll miss it. It's not a very big place at all.
Which is exactly the type of place where Eaglemania does particularly well.
But it's one of the places, it's like Mayberry here, man. Everybody knows everybody.
Right.
And when you're downtown, you just have this community feeling.
Right. I love it.
Very small, together place.
Right,
yeah.
Right.
Western Pennsylvania, we're drawing from Michigan, Ohio, Maryland, New York. I know that this year I've sold tickets to California, Canada, and England was the big one. Do like a national at least twice a year.
Right.
The last national we had was Grammy Award winning bluegrass artist Rhonda Vincent. She was 3 weeks ago.
Wow.
But we've had Scott Stapp here, John Waite.
I love John Waite.
John.
Yeah, he's amazing.
He's still got the pipes too.
Right.
So, Rick Emmett was in from Triumph, who's absolutely still got it, man. He's an amazing guitarist, but he's got that high range that he always had. Which anybody that's in their 60s that can still hit the tenor notes always blows me away.
Awesome.
We're growing. Awesome. We're looking for more Marshall Tucker, Kirk Gregory, the Outlaws. We do a lot of Southern Rock.
Right. That's great.
We're trying to build it up now.
Okay, so now for what was the most challenging leg of the whole trip, the 234 miles between Latrobe and Caldwell. I wanted to get home relatively early as it was Mother's Day, but 48 hours out, I knew I was going to be contending with some challenging IFR conditions at Caldwell. The morning forecast yielded a low just to my south with forecasted heavy rain along my route. The TAFs for all the New York airports called for northeasterly winds with IFR conditions, specifically 800-foot ceilings and 3 to 5 miles visibility with little improvement over the course of the day. 800-foot ceilings and 3 miles visibility is not so bad for a precision approach, but the winds at Caldwell favored runway 4, which is served by a non-precision RNAV approach with minima of 620 and 1, which is 448 feet AGL. METARs 4 hours before my arrival were right at minimums, and the graphical METARs showed improvement to the northeast. As far as icing goes, the freeze level was forecast to be around 9,000 feet, and the SIPFIP called for moderate to heavy icing in the low teens. NEXRAD wasn't too happy either, with areas of heavy precipitation along the entire route. So here was the plan. As far as the ceilings and visibilities were concerned, I filed for Caldwell with Teterboro, which has an ILS, as an alternate, the bailout being an airport somewhere to the northeast where conditions were more favorable. I filed for 27,000 feet and knew that if I stayed above 21,000 or below 11,000, I would be out of the ice. For fuel, with full tanks, I had 4 hours of endurance and enough to go round trip with lots of options. I headed out to the airport, which was about a half hour away, picked up my clearance, which was as filed, and took off into the rain and marginal conditions.
Over to tower. Reporting 2600 overcast here and 5 miles visibility, which I find a little hard to believe.
All this meant was that I was going to give it one good shot at Caldwell, and if I couldn't get in, I would just go over to Teterboro.
2 Niner Delta Alpha on departure, runway heading maintain 8,000, wind 24010, clear for takeoff.
Okay, clear for takeoff, runway heading 8,000, 9 Delta Alpha, thank you. So this could be straight out, runway heading 8,000. Okay, airspeed's live, 60 knots, cross-check. Good for 85 to rotate. bars gear up. We're on in a climb to 8,000.
And soon I was cleared into the flight levels.
November 9 Delta Alpha, come maintain flight level 230.
Okay, 230, 9 Delta Alpha. And any reports of icing along my route?
November 9 Delta Alpha, I just had an aircraft in that area descending into Pittsburgh from 22, and he said he didn't run into any icing, just a little bit of light pop.
Okay, thank you, 9 Delta Alpha.
I find with icing that there's nothing more useful than pyreps.
So we're climbing through now 13,000, actually 14,000, and this is where the freezing level is. So I'm going to put on the prop install heat because we have visible moisture. Keep an eye on those wings. And the tail. Just a tiny bit of rime. Okay, so we're leveled off at flight level 230.
174, contact
and,
New York Center 123.62.
2362, United Center 174. New York Brickyard.
You can see what's going on here, just a mess. And the current, we're waiting for the Sirius XM to update the METAR, which is about an hour and 15 minutes old right there. Trying to receive it, let's see.
Delta 944, New York Center, right?
On NGPS, only 4 approaching use, landing at the departing runway 4. Delta
929 Delta Alpha, it's going to maintain flight level 190.
Flight level 109 Delta Alpha.
555, observe. Call without information, echo 1253 Zulu, wind 060 at 8, just 17, visibility 1 1/2. Light rain, mist, ceiling 700 broken, 1100 overcast. Temperature 8, Jupiter, altimeter 3000. Ceiling variable between 500 and 900. On NGPS only 4.
Okay, so nothing's really changed. This is going to be where we're going to have icing.
Icing was a non-issue, and the remainder of the descent was uneventful.
We're going to keep an eye out for that.
Wing 30, climb 18, 16,000.
16,000, wing 30.
A little while later, while I was with New York and being vectored for the approach, something interesting happened.
Envoy 4209 after suite, fly heading 090.
Roger, after suite, heading 090, Envoy 4209.
United 700, left 220.
That's the autopilot disconnect alarm. A couple months back, while en route and at altitude, I had an autopilot disconnect for what appeared to be a pitch servo problem. After resetting the autopilot circuit breaker, I was able to restore it. After pulling the Garmin logs, my mechanic and I agreed that if it happened again, we would replace the servo under the assumption that the servo was going bad.
Okay, we just had an AFCS failure.
This time it picked a lousy moment to declare itself. I cycled the circuit breaker a couple times and was able to get it back online while hand flying and accepting vectors.
Turn right 170, gonna be just a short delaying S turn for your approach. I got a conflicting traffic land in Morristown. I gotta kinda just widen you out just a little bit.
170, 9 Delta Alpha.
Setting up for a non-precision approach in low inclement weather and now an equipment issue. This is why I train every 6 months. Fly the airplane.
Air China 819 or heavy, descend and maintain 6,000, fly heading 200.
Descend and maintain 6,000, flight heading 200, Air China 819.
It should go without saying that that servo has been replaced.
929 Delta Alpha, turn left heading 120.
120, 9 Delta Alpha. Okay, so we solved that problem.
Go to the tower, 120, thanks you all today.
9 Delta Alpha, you're over Yovan, you're cleared on GPS 4 approach inbound Caldwell.
Okay, clear for the approach, 9 Delta Alpha. Okay, so we're inside Yovan. When we cross Zoga, it's going to be drop the gear and
United
start to descend to...
United 883, heading 200, descend 6,000.
Descend to 1100 to cross Weasel at 1100. Bottoms at 660, and the mist is a climb to 2700.
9 Delta Alpha, Tower 119.8.
Over to Tower, thanks for your help, 9 Delta Alpha.
Air China 819 Heavy.
Call tower, Meridian 929 Delta Alpha, it's with the outside, so good.
Meridian 929 Delta Alpha, call tower, altimeter 29er, 99er, winds are 040 at 13.
Vertical track.
Runway 4, clear to land.
Okay, clear to land 49 Delta F.
Winds are now 050 at 10, gust 20.
Thank you.
As I crossed the final approach fix, I dropped the gear and configured for landing.
We got three in the green, two, 20 degrees of flaps. Last notch of flaps when we have the runway in sight.
And here's where the next interesting thing happened. It was raining so hard that the right pitot tube actually was blocked with water. Check out the IAS miscompare at the upper right of the co-pilot PFD. Once again, having to hand fly the airplane, it became immediately apparent which side the problem was on. Based upon the backup gauges, the ground speed, and how the airplane was configured, the problem was clearly on the right.
We have the runway in sight, bases at 1,000.
It was raining so hard, you could hear it very clearly over the windshield. And here's a little sample of the audio of that.
500.
Winds are 040 at 12, gusts 18.
Even once I had the airplane on the ground at a standstill, the right side was indicating 30 knots. None of the static drains yielded any water. And once the airplane had a chance to dry out, the problem resolved. Three flights, each with their own challenges. To me, this is what it's all about. Making decisions, adjusting plans, using the system, all to make this incredible machine practical and most importantly, safe. Here's what's up in the next episode of Life in the Fast Lane. Three shows, in three states, in 3 days, and some serious weather to contend with. That's Life in the Fast Lane.